Hello everyone, let us look at the image sampling. So before going to the image sampling, in the last chapter I have given an assignment regarding optical and modulation transfer functions. The definition for optical transfer function is as follows. For a spatially invariant imaging system, the optical transfer function is defined as OTF is equal to h of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 divided by h of 0 comma 0, where h of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 is nothing but the Fourier transform of the impulse response of the system h of m comma n. So the modulation transfer function is the modulus of the OTF, which is nothing but modulus of h of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 divided by modulus of h of 0 comma 0. So what is this h of dividing with h of 0 comma 0 represents? H of 0 comma 0 is supposed to be the maximum value of h of zeta 1 comma zeta 2. So in a way we are dividing it with the maximum value, which will always return the function to have a maximum value of 1. I am repeating, h of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 will have the maximum value to be h of 0 comma 0. If I divide it with h of 0 comma 0, then the maximum value of the OTF will be 1. So moving on to the image sampling. So sampling is nothing but discretization of the independent variable of the signal. Let us say f of t is the signal that we are looking at, and when we sample the signal we will get fs of t, let us say. So sampling the signal is nothing but multiplying the signal with the impulse train. So fs of t is equal to f of t multiplied with summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite delta of t minus nts. So this multiplication of f of t with the impulse train will result in summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite f of nts multiplied with delta of t minus nts. You can see f of t multiplied with delta of t minus nts is nothing but f of nts multiplied with delta of t minus nts. So what happened actually, the impulse train is get modulated with the value of f of t. This is actually f of minus ts, this is f of 0, this is f of ts. Okay, f of t at the values 0, ts, 2 ts, 3 ts, minus ts, minus 2 ts, minus 3 ts, so on till minus infinite here and so on till infinite here is taken, you know, and we are calling that as the sample signal fs of t. This is, you can see that we are sampling the signal at uniform intervals, so this is called as uniform sampling. Now what is the whole idea here? The whole idea here is to get the signal and represent it with minimal using minimal memory, and which can enable us to send the signal with a minimum bandwidth, and at the receiver again we have to go back to the original signal f of t. So f of t to fs of t is sampling, and fs of t to f of t, when we do that, we should be able to get back the original signal f of t. We should be able to reconstruct f of t from fs of t. So what is the minimum sampling rate that ensures perfect reconstruction? This is very important. If f of t cannot be recovered from fs of t, then the sampling is not valid. Our signal is lost, the information is lost. So we have to make sure that the sampling rate is sufficient to get back the signal f of t from fs of t. So in order to get that, let us assume that f of t is a band limited signal. What is a band limited signal? A signal which is having a non-zero spectrum between given range of frequencies, and everywhere else it should be zero. You can see f of t here is having the spectrum to be non-zero from minus zeta m to zeta m, and everywhere else is equal to zero. So you have to remember, a band limited signal cannot be time limited, and a time limited signal cannot be band limited. A signal cannot be both time limited as well as band limited. It's because of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. You are all well aware of that, right? So Let us consider the fs of t and see what is the spectrum of f of t in terms of the spectrum of f of t. Okay, so what I am saying, we are trying to compute fs of t in terms of the spectrum of f of t. Okay, we have assumed that the spectrum of f of t is f of zeta. You may have a doubt that why I have considered a triangular spectrum here. It is not, there's nothing to have the shape, we have nothing related to the shape of the spectrum. The space, the shape of the spectrum can be anything, it can be arbitrary. Why I have drawn a triangular shape is, it is easy to draw, nothing more than that. So let us compute the spectrum of fs of t. The spectrum of fs of t, we can obtain it by taking the Fourier transform. Fourier transform of fs of t is given by Fourier transform of this signal f of t multiplied with summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite delta of t minus nts. Fourier transform of multiplication of two signals is nothing but convolution of their spectra. So Fourier transform of f of t is equal to f of zeta, and Fourier transform of the impulse train is nothing but again impulse train. So how did we get this? This is already known to you because you have learned this in DSP course. Okay, so you can take this as an assignment. Okay, now the spectrum of fs of t is fs of zeta, and this is equal to zeta s multiplied with summation over k equal to minus infinite to infinite f of zeta convolved with delta of zeta minus k zeta s. F of zeta convolved with delta of zeta minus k zeta s is nothing but f of zeta minus k zeta s. This is from the shifting property of the impulse function, and we have taken this f of zeta, the convolution, inside this summation, because the convolution is a linear operation, hence these operations are interchangeable. Now you can see that the spectrum fs of zeta is nothing but summation of f of zeta, which is corresponding to k equal to 0, and f of zeta minus zeta s when k is equal to 1, f of zeta minus 2 zeta s when k equal to 2, so on till infinite, and when k equal to minus 1, f of zeta plus zeta s when k equal to minus 2, f of zeta plus 2 zeta s, so on till minus infinite. So this is pretty interesting. Fs of zeta is nothing but the original spectrum of the signal f of t, and then the summation of the original signal and the shifted versions of the spectrum again. I am repeating, it is nothing but the summation of the signal, the spectrum of the signal and its shifted versions from k equal to minus infinite to infinite. So this is the original spectrum, which is f of zeta, which is non-zero from minus zeta m to zeta m, and everywhere it is equal to 0. This is also called as the baseband spectrum. Now fs of zeta, it has a multiplication factor of 1 over ts for the normalization purpose. We got this here, zeta s. This zeta s is nothing but 1 over ts. And then the original spectrum, its shifted versions. This is for k equal to 1, corresponding to k equal to 1. This is corresponding to k equal to 2, k equal to minus 1, k equal to minus 2, so on. So this will go till minus infinite, this will go to till plus infinite. This is going to repeat, this spectrum is going to repeat till plus infinite here, and this spectrum is going to repeat till minus infinite here. And you can see, when k equal to 0, the baseband we will get. When k equal to 1, the spectrum got shifted to zeta s. The maximum value here is zeta s plus zeta m, and the minimum value is zeta s minus zeta m. And when k equal to 2, this is 2 zeta s plus zeta m, 2 zeta s minus zeta m. And here, if you see, this is minus zeta s for k equal to minus 1. This spectrum will be shifted to minus zeta s, and minus zeta s, then the this will be moved to minus zeta s plus zeta m, and this end will move to minus zeta s minus zeta m,
and when k equal to minus 2, this is the center frequency is minus 2 zeta s, and this frequency, you know, the upper cutoff, the upper frequency is minus 2 zeta s plus zeta m, and this is minus 2 zeta s minus zeta m. Now the whole point is that I have drawn this spectrum here assuming that zeta s is greater than zeta s minus zeta m is greater than zeta m. You can see that this value is pretty much greater than this value because this is occurring, you know, to the right of this value. So zeta s minus zeta m is greater than zeta m. So zeta s is greater than 2 zeta m. If that is the case, this is what we will get. This, the difference between this and this is nothing but zeta s minus 2 zeta m. This is called as guard band. You are all well aware of this. And the next case is when zeta s is equal to 2 zeta m, you can see that the guard band is going to become 0. So here you can see that the guard band is 0. So this is called as critical sampling case. This is called as critical sampling case. And the next one is undersampling. By the way, this is oversampling. The next one is undersampling. Undersampling is when zeta s is less than 2 zeta m. When zeta s is less than 2 zeta m, this zeta s minus zeta m is going to, you know, come somewhere here, which is less than zeta m. That is why I have drawn it here. So zeta s minus zeta m is here and zeta m is here. And this is, you can say, 2 zeta s minus zeta m, and this is zeta s plus zeta m. So on. So you can see the side bands, upper side bands are getting, you can say, you know, mixed with the baseband spectrum and the lower bands. Okay. So this is an important concept called as aliasing. What is aliasing? Aliasing is nothing but when we do undersampling, the higher frequencies will pose as lower frequencies. The higher frequencies will pose as lower frequencies because of undersampling. This is called as aliasing. Okay. So how to avoid aliasing? We can avoid aliasing by limiting the spectrum of the given signal f of t, which is f of zeta, you can say, to zeta s by 2. So if we limit the maximum frequency cutoff, you know, the maximum frequency component in the signal f of t to zeta s by 2, then we will not have aliasing. In another way, I'm putting it in another way again. If we sample the signal greater than twice of the maximum frequency component in the signal, then we will not get aliasing. There are two ways: taking an higher sampling frequency, which is higher than twice of the maximum frequency component, and the second way is to limit the signal to have frequency components less than zeta s by 2. How do we do that? By taking a low pass filter, which is called as anti-aliasing filter. Now let us actually look at the problem we are interested in. How to get back from f of zeta to, I mean to say, fs of zeta to f of zeta. So you can see f of zeta is nothing but this part of the spectrum. That means we just need to remove the side bands and keep the baseband spectrum in the sampled spectrum. In the spectrum of the sampled signal, we need to keep the baseband spectrum and remove the side bands. How do we do that? By using a simple low pass filter. So this is the low pass filter I am talking about. We can reconstruct the signal from the samples by taking a low pass filter, which allows the baseband spectrum and removes all the higher frequency components and the sidebands, right? So f of zeta can be reconstructed by using a low pass filter with frequency response. H of zeta is equal to 1 over zeta s for mod zeta less than or equal to zeta c. Zeta c is the cutoff frequency, you know, the critical frequency, cutoff frequency, not critical, cutoff frequency, and it is equal to 0 otherwise. So you can obtain the constructed signal by multiplying the spectrum of the original signal with the impulse, you know, the transfer function of the low pass filter, which is called as the reconstruction filter. FR of zeta is equal to f of zeta, the spectrum of the original, this is fs of zeta, the spectrum of the sample signal, with h of zeta, the transfer function of the reconstruction filter.
So the spectrum of the reconstructed signal FR of zeta is given by the multiplication of spectrum of the sample signal, which is FS of zeta, correct it for yourself, FS of zeta multiplied with H of zeta, the transfer function of the reconstruction filter. Now let us obtain FR of T, the reconstructed signal. So FR of T is nothing but FS of T convolved with H of T. FS of T is the sample signal and H of T is the impulse response of the reconstruction filter. H of T can be obtained by computing the inverse Fourier transform of H of zeta, which is given by integral over minus infinite to infinite H of zeta multiplied with e power j 2 pi zeta t d zeta. So H of zeta I am substituting. This is a non-zero between minus zeta c to zeta c and everywhere else it is zero. So this integral now becomes integral over minus zeta c to zeta c 1 over zeta s multiplied with e power j 2 pi zeta t d zeta. This is equal to 1 over zeta s. I am bringing this out, and e power 2 pi zeta t, when we do the integration, this is e power j 2 pi zeta t divided by 2 pi t with the limits zeta c to minus zeta c, and when we replace this zeta with zeta c, this is e power j 2 pi zeta c t minus, and when we replace this zeta with minus zeta c, this is e power minus j 2 pi zeta c t divided by the 2 pi t. Now, so H of t is this is what we get, you know, this e power j theta minus e power minus j theta by 2 j is actually sine theta. So there's a j missing here. However, we are there's a j missing here. You just need to add that up. Did we miss a j? Yeah, actually there's a j coming here because this is e power j 2 pi zeta t. This should be 2 j pi t here. This should be 2 j pi t, and the sine theta is nothing but e power j theta minus e power minus j theta by 2 j. So that j you have to add, correct it for yourself again. So h of t is equal to 1 over zeta s multiplied with sine 2 pi zeta c t divided by pi t, and I have rearranged it such that I will get it in the form that sine pi theta divided by pi theta. So zeta c divided by zeta s, I have multiplied the denominator and the numerator with zeta c. Zeta c divided by zeta s multiplied with sine 2 pi zeta c t divided by pi zeta c t. Let us assume that zeta c is equal to zeta s by 2, the critical frequency. It is the maximum frequency component that is allowed is zeta s by 2. So that's why I am assuming zeta c is equal to zeta s by 2. So this is zeta c is replaced with zeta s by 2 now. Zeta s by 2 divided by zeta s multiplied with sine 2 pi zeta s by 2 into t divided by pi in place of zeta c, zeta c again, zeta s by 2 multiplied with t. So what is going to happen? This zeta s is going to get cancelled. Half of this is going to get cancelled. This will become sine pi zeta s t divided by pi zeta s t. This is nothing but your sinc function. This is sinc of zeta s t. This is what we will get. So FR of t is nothing but FS of t convolved with H of t, which is nothing but summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite. FS of t, we already know, is F of n t s multiplied with summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite. F of n t s multiplied with delta of t minus n t s. And H of t is sinc of zeta s t. This convolution is a linear operation. So the summation and the convolution can be interchanged. So if we do that, then delta of t minus nts convolved with the sinc of zeta s t is nothing but sinc of zeta s multiplied with t minus nts. This is by using the shifting property of the impulse response, shifting property of the impulse function. So what we get is summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite f of nts multiplied with the sinc of zeta s multiplied with t minus nts. So if I take this zeta s inside,
This is summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite f of nts multiplied with sinc of zeta s t minus n into ts into zeta s is equal to 1, because zeta s is equal to 1 over ts. And sinc, you know, just for the sake of completeness, I am expanding this sinc to be equal to sine pi theta by pi theta. So this is equal to summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite f of nts multiplied with sine of pi multiplied with zeta st minus n divided by zeta st minus n multiplied with pi. So this is how we can get the reconstructed signal. This reconstructed signal will be almost same as the original signal if zeta s is greater than or equal to the twice the maximum frequency component of the signal. Similarly, for the two dimensional case, the sampled image can be obtained by multiplying the image with the two dimensional impulse train. Fs of x comma y is equal to f of x comma y multiplied with summation over m equal to minus infinite to infinite, summation over n equal to minus infinite to infinite delta of x minus m delta x comma y minus n delta y, where delta x is a sampling interval along the x axis and delta y is a sampling interval along the y axis. You need to keep in mind that there ts is a sampling time period. Here delta x and delta y are the sampling intervals which are having the units of say either centimeter or you can say inch. They're basically distances or spatial variables. So this is nothing but summation over m equal to minus infinite and summation over n equal to minus infinite f of x comma y is now replaced with f of m delta x comma n delta y multiplied with delta of x minus m delta x comma y minus n delta y, again using the shifting property of the impulse function. So we are using here the separability property of the impulse function. We know what is the separable function and all. F of x comma y, if it can be written as f1 of x multiplied with f2 of y, then we can call that as a separable function. So here we have delta of x comma y. Delta of x comma y is equal to delta of x multiplied with delta of y, which is a separable function. So we are using the separable function and the separability property of the Fourier transform here. The spectrum of the sampled image is given by fs of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 is equal to f of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 convolved with the Fourier transform of the two-dimensional impulse train, which is equal to f of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 convolved with using the separability property. We have got that here. The Fourier transform of the two-dimensional impulse train, we got it using the separability property of the Fourier transform. So which is turned out to be zeta xs multiplied with zeta ys multiplied with summation over k equal to minus infinite to infinite summation over l equal to minus infinite to infinite delta of zeta 1 minus k zeta xs multiplied comma zeta 2 minus l zeta ys, where zeta xs is equal to 1 by delta x and zeta ys is equal to 1 by delta y. Using, we can say the convolution property is again linear. The convolution is again linear. Hence, we can we can interchange the summation and the convolution here. So, this is turns out to be zeta xs multiplied with zeta ys multiplied with summation over k equal to minus infinite to infinite, summation over l equal to minus infinite to infinite. F of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 convolved with the impulse train is nothing but f of zeta 1 minus k zeta xs comma zeta 2 minus L zeta ys. So again, this is nothing but the baseband spectrum of the image and the summation of this baseband spectrum of the image and its sampled versions. So let us assume that again this image is a band limited image, which means that f of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 is equal to 0 when mod zeta 1 is greater than zeta x naught and mod zeta 2 is greater than zeta y naught, where zeta x naught is the maximum spatial frequency component along x axis and along x axis, and mod zeta 2 is greater than zeta y naught, right? So zeta y naught is the maximum frequency component along the y axis, along the y dimension we'll say. So you can say that here this is the baseband spectrum. Let us assume that this is the baseband spectrum and the spectrum of the sampled image is this, the baseband spectrum and its shifted versions. This is shifted to here along the x-axis by zeta xs, and you know, to the left by again minus zeta xs, along the y-axis zeta ys and minus zeta ys. You can see that zeta, you know, again the aliasing and all we can explain in the case of the two-dimensional case also. This is the impulse train for you, the sampling grid we call this. Along the x-axis it is there, the sampling interval is delta x, and along the y-axis the sample interval is delta y. You know, you have an analog image, and you are, when we multiply that with this impulse train, we will get the samples only at these samples on the grid. So whatever we have seen in the one dimensional case can be easily extended to the two dimensional case. So the reconstructed, this is the case of aliasing. If we do the undersampling, then this will move here onto the baseband spectrum. These side bands will move to the baseband spectrum, and because of that aliasing happens. Again, aliasing is nothing but the high frequencies forcing as low frequencies, and aliasing can be avoided here again by using a two-dimensional low-pass filter. Now you can limit the image to have frequency components less than zeta xs by 2 along x-axis and zeta ys by 2 along the y-axis. Yeah, you can see the reconstructed image. The reconstructed image is given by f of x comma y is equal to summation over m comma n equal to minus infinite to infinite f of m delta x comma n delta y multiplied with sine of x zeta xs minus m multiplied with pi divided by x zeta xs minus m multiplied with pi multiplied with sine of y zeta ys minus n multiplied with pi divided by y zeta ys minus n multiplied with pi. This is a straightforward result from the one dimensional case. You know, because of the separability property of the Fourier transform, we can directly write in the two dimensional as a product of two one dimensional signals. Next one, again, aliasing and reconstruction filter we have completed. Aliasing we can avoid by taking a two-dimensional low-pass filter whose cutoff frequencies are equal to half of the maximum of, you know, half of the sampling frequencies zeta xs comma zeta ys respectively. So let us look into a problem. Let us consider an image f of x comma y is equal to 2 cos of 2 pi 3x plus 4y. Now the question is, what happens if we undersample the signal? What is the reconstructed signal? Let us look into it. So if this image is sampled at delta x equal to delta y equal to 0.2, what will be the reconstructed signal? Let us see. F of x comma y is equal to 2 cos of 2 pi into 3x plus 4y. So f of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 is equal to delta of zeta 1 minus comma 3 comma zeta 2 minus 4 plus delta of zeta 1 plus 3 comma zeta 2 plus 4. We already know that for cos signal, for cos of 2 pi f naught t, the spectrum will be delta of f minus f naught plus delta of f plus f naught. So from that we can directly write the spectrum of this signal as this one. So f of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 is equal to delta of zeta 1 minus comma 3 comma zeta 2 minus 4 plus delta of zeta 1 plus 3 comma zeta 2 plus 4. Now we can see that this is a band limited signal, because for mod zeta 1 greater than 3 and mod zeta 2 greater than 4, this spectrum is equal to 0. So the maximum frequency components are 3 and 4 along x and y directions respectively. Now in order to get the complete signal, in order to get the reconstructed signal, which is approximately equal to the original signal, we need to sample it with at least 6 along the x direction and 8 along the y direction. But for the given sampling scenario, zeta xs is given as 1 over delta x, which is equal to 1 over 0.2, which is 5, and zeta ys is given as 1 over zeta 1 over 0.2, again 5. Now as I said, zeta xs should be 6 and zeta ys should be 8. This is a definitely undersampling case, and the expected result will be like we'll get a we'll get a reconstructed signal which is not equal to the original signal, meaning that we'll lose our information. So let us obtain the spectrum of the sampled image. The spectrum of the sampled image, we already know zeta xs, we can see that here. Zeta xs multiplied with zeta ys, summation over k equal to minus infinite to infinite, summation over l equal to minus infinite to infinite, f of zeta 1 minus k zeta xs, comma zeta 2 minus l zeta ys. Here zeta xs is equal to 5, zeta ys is equal to 5. So this turns out to be, and f of zeta 1, zeta 1 comma zeta 2, we already know this is equal to delta of zeta 1 minus 3 comma zeta 2 minus 4 plus delta of zeta 1 plus 3 comma zeta 2 plus 4. So let us substitute all these things in this expression. We will get 25 multiplied with summation over k comma l equal to minus infinite to infinite, delta of zeta 1 minus 3 minus 5k, zeta 2 minus 4 minus 5l plus delta of zeta 1 plus 3 minus 5k comma zeta 2 plus 4 minus 5l. The baseband spectrum generally will be corresponding to k equal to 0 and l equal to 0. So if we put k equal to 0, this will be delta of zeta 1 minus 8 and zeta 2 minus 9. This will be delta of zeta 1 minus 3 plus, zeta 2 minus 4, and here zeta 1 plus 3 comma zeta 2 plus 4. So this is supposed to be baseband spectrum. But when we are taking this sort of sampling scenario, the reconstruction filter will be this: h of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 is equal to 1 over 25 for mod zeta 1 less than or equal to 2.5 and mod zeta 2 less than or equal to 2.5, otherwise it should be equal to 0, which means that it will allow only the frequencies which are less than 2.5, but the baseband spectrum here is having 3 and 4 along x and y direction respectively. So the baseband spectrum is completely gone for us. Now, what are the frequencies that are less than 2.5? Let us see. When we put when k is equal to 1, this will be zeta 1 minus 3 minus 5, which is minus 8, and minus 4 minus 5, which is minus 9. This will not be considered because both of them are greater than 2.5. And here you can see 3 minus 5, k equal to 1, right? 3 minus 5 is minus 2, and 4 minus 5 is minus 1. So similarly, when k equal to minus 1, we will get the corresponding values to be 2 and 1. So the reconstructed signal, the spectrum of the reconstructed image will have these frequencies 2 and 1. So f tilde of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 will be equal to delta of zeta 1 minus 2 comma zeta 2 minus 1 plus delta of zeta 1 plus 2 comma zeta 2 plus 1. I am repeating, if you substitute k equal to 1 and l equal to 1 in this expression, you will get minus 2 and minus 1, 2 and 1 as the frequencies. And when you plot k equal to minus 1 and l equal to minus 1, you will get the frequencies, minus 2 and minus 1. And hence, these are the only frequencies which are less than 2.5. And hence, f tilde of zeta 1 comma zeta 2, which will have only frequencies that are less than 2.5, because we are going to multiply fs of zeta 1 comma zeta 2 with h of zeta 1 comma zeta 2. Will contain only the frequencies 2 and 1 and minus 2 and minus 1, of course, the mirror of it. So the reconstructed image will be a field of x comma y is equal to 2 cos 2 pi multiplied with 2x plus y. This is definitely a undersampling case, and if you want to get a proper reconstructed signal, you should be you should make sure that your sampling frequencies are greater than 6 and 8 respectively. I am giving you this as an assignment. Obtain this reconstructed signal when zeta 1 is equal to, let us say, 8. We will take both zeta xs and zeta ys as 10. And I want you to reconstruct the signal. Okay. So, take that as assignment. With this, image sampling is completed.